Thanks, Ross. So I've got the job of the so what of all of this. You know, what does this really mean for our farming businesses? And what are some of the things we need to be thinking about, planning about and doing to make the best possible outcome out of, no doubt, a challenging period going forward? I'm not really punching the air with a heap of joy at the moment. We do need to actually just take the step of, okay, what is, a sense of reality with it all. And then, what's within our control and what can we do about it? And even when the best laid out plans might need to change, and we guarantee that will be the case this year. But what is within our control? I just want to get a feel from people here about, so what have we heard so far?
Today or from farmers in the last couple of weeks?
The collective. We had to use our collective sort of in information gathering. So what have we heard today? What are we hearing out there? What are some of the things we're hearing? Or heard?
Farmers terribly worried about the price of transferable
water. Yep. What else have we heard? Possibly? Yep. What else have we heard?
Probably not going to rain.
I'm just going to leave it like that for a moment, okay? What else have we heard?
Probably no pressure, not a great deal of pressure on finance costs.
Thank you, Baker. Got to have one win. Anything else? What did we hear from Dale? Bit of that? Right. Not feeling any better yet.
Next year probably going to be worse than this year.
Right. What else?
This year's looking better than next year.
Right. Anything else?
I'll add something to that. That overall, this is how it's looking, but however it looks, it's highly likely to change.
Absolutely. And that wasn't plugged or initiated response. Things will change. And one thing for sure that we need to do from a farming business is, mightn't like to hear all this stuff, but first of all, we've got to say, well, what does that mean for my business? Where am I currently situated? And then what might I do to make this as better as good as I can do? And absolutely, things will change. And keeping abreast of that, keeping monitoring of where things are at, is absolutely the must do in this year. And more so this year than other years, because when we've got a bit of buffer in the job, and we make a mistake or two, we can, usually say, well, that's, that won't change greatly, but, or my bottom line, I can live with it. But when it's tight, every post has got to be a winner, and we've got to keep a close eye on things. Just about where we're at, and not wanting to be real, but also to know that that can change. We are obviously, from a seasonal point of view, in a really critical time where things are going to have the most change. The next 10, 12 weeks are really going to set our scene. As Mark pointed out, 8 weeks ago, where the inflows were tracking, stimulated them to actually add that extra line in the extreme dry situation, because that's where it was. It's better than that, but not a hell of a lot better. But we have got those important inflows months ahead of us. Keeping a track of that, and Mark tells me that very shortly they'll be actually giving the actual where the inflows are sitting for the Goldman system, in a very sort of like press the button on that Goldman Murray Water Resource page, which is a fantastic site that really gives you a lot of good information. Already now on the, with the Murray-Darling Basin Authority, they have a weekly update of river data, and that gives you today's information. And that's really, really useful to be looking at tracking to see how things are changing and in live time. I haven't got it on this screen here, but when that graph and that they have on the Murray-Darling Basin site for the Murray system, had our inflows last year sort of tracking quite okay, and then what happened last year after about now? Do you remember last year?
It stopped raining.
It really dropped away really quite quickly. The long-term average is sort of more like this. This is an inflow point of view. And where we started this, where we're sitting this year on the Murray system, is that we started pretty poor, hence that extreme dry sort of scenario. But if we look at it the last couple of days, it is actually pointing in the right direction. Still a long way to go, but we just got to keep a track on it and see where it does end up. And Durham, that one there, that's all about supply, and supply is all about what's actually going to flow in. And I just want to reiterate that comment that Mark made about the whole system. We do have to, from a water point of view, look at the whole system. It's not just what's going on in the Goldman system and the Murray system, it's what's going on just as importantly across the river. And unfortunately, it's not great over there. And as Mark said, they've got a 0% at the moment. And even with average inflows, they're looking only at like a 35% allocation. And from a relativity point of view, they got to 62 last year. And that's on a lot of water. So this is general security water. There's about 1,300 gigalitres of it. So it's a supply issue, and a supply issue we don't want to know about, but we have to know about. Where it all will end up, I haven't got a crystal ball. But certainly the next 10 weeks are so, so important. So what does it mean for us? A few things we all know really, really well is that what will happen, what gets delivered to us will have a wide impact on every single farm. There's a whole heap of differences where farms are situated. Everyone gets a bit of a different milk price. Nowadays, more so than where you were used to be, farms have got a big difference in their exposure to the allocation market, with what people have done with entitlements and whether they own it or not. people get a different response out of what that water gets used on. They've got different intensities, different farming systems that they're employing, and how all that washes in together, and what will be their final result, and what decisions will be good for them and maybe not good for others, will be just such a unique position. So every farm is different. Every farm's got to work it through. No recipe ever, and more so now. If we just step back a step from last year and just look at where we've been, this time last year we did a similar thing and looked at outlooks and, you know, looking forward. And it, you know, here were some of the settings we thought we were going to get to, and here we were where we actually got to. And so we very rarely get it right, but probably not too bad in where we were sitting last year. Bit more stability in the job. And this year, with all these big levels of uncertainty, where we think things might sit at the moment to where they might could be quite different. And hence, we've really got to keep an eye on those changes. Milk price, a huge driver. Norm before said the three big things for confidence was milk price, seasonal conditions, and input prices. And so for us right at the moment, there's some big question marks on all three of those. So there's understandable, there's a nervousness out there. What can we do about milk price, Durham?
Milk price is what milk price is, and on farm we can't do anything.
Yeah, minor. You know, we can work on our quality as we always should do, all that sort of stuff, but basically the guts of it, we can't do much about it. It is a big driver, but cost of production has a huge impact as well. What can we do about that? Tomo?
Manage it.
There is certain things, obviously, we still can't control about our cost of production, like, yeah, what's this going to be and what we're going to have to pay for hay and grain. But how we bring it all together is very much in our control, and working through what's the best combination and what's the best decisions to make is very much in our control. As I said here, the seasonal conditions, and primarily spring. Spring is always the bee's knees. It sets us up to delivers really what we're going to be in for. Whatever happens after about November, from an inflow point of view, Mark, what's 3/8 of not much. So yeah, I guess our fate to somewhat we'll know, in the next little while. And that those seasonal conditions will inevitably have a flow through on all of these things, the water price, the hay price, and the grain price. Norm, he stepped out, is he? There he is. Sorry, mate. Just looking over there. Norm talked about a little bit of international market sort of, good news from our perspective from a grain, but he uses the word sticky. And that obviously our seasonal position here and what gets grown locally will influence that significantly. The other thing too, I guess, in Dale's picture, was a bit Victorian-centric. So we had a good picture of Victoria. But then when we look at the bigger picture of the Australia's grain situation, West Aussie, from a water point of view, looked not too bad. Parts of New South Wales looking not too bad. So that's part of the full picture. We've got to get out of this thinking about just our local. We've got to look broader. Beef prices. Did you talk about beef prices or cow prices in your thing?
No. they're certainly making some cows nervous.
Yeah. Well, not a good year to be an underperformer. Never is. But it certainly, if we're looking about where we're going to sit with our cows and the like, at least there's some ability to, you know, get some cash flow with some pretty solid money there on that market. And I'll talk a little bit about, you know, how far we might want to go there in a tick. But a good thing. So what does this all mean for us at the moment? knowing that a heck of a lot of things can change from where we sit from today. But every business should be looking and doing this is, okay, where does it sit for me? What does it mean for my farm? Now, we've just pulled out a farm that's, you know, based on through the Dairy Farm Monitor stuff, so it's real in terms of, you know, realistic. 300 odd cows, 500 kilos milk solids, grazing about 7.5 tonnes of paddock feed and conserving 1.5. A debt of around about a bit over $1 million, equity at 58%. And we just put this into the Murray Dairy Business Tool, and people may be aware of it, but it's no magic thing. It's just a spreadsheet. Just puts all your numbers in and just allows you to do some calculations quickly rather than, you know, 100 punches of the calculator. So, at the moment, you know, got some settings. Water allocations, 90%. Milk price at 580, grain price 350, hay price 200, allocation price around the $200 mark. They're the settings at the, you know, at the moment that we've got plugged into this tool. This is income less cash costs, and we're sitting positive. Are people confident about that? Got a positive outcome. You beauty. Go home, nothing to worry about. Yes, no? Bit of a wink of the eye there. Any one of those things going the wrong way obviously starts to impact in here. And we want to look, and part of our thinking is sensitivities. We have actually opened around about the 560 mark, right? 580 was actually to try and get a bit of a positive. Will we move on that? Got to watch. Will it go the other way? We've got to watch. But we have to, every business needs to look at what does it mean for them currently? What do the what ifs mean for me? And what can I then do about it? And the tool's just got sensitivities around these three key ones. And what we need to actually do modify is put the sensitivity to that water price in there as well. But that sensitivity on the water price is going to be varied a fair bit for people, isn't it, Darren?
Depending on what allocation used alone.
That's right. And then what allocation we get on that entitlement that we own will influence our exposure. And as will the what we can get, our 8 tonnes off our paddocks, all those things will influence where we end up at. And to get to that cash position, we've obviously got all our other, you know, our milk returns, our stock trading returns, all the costs associated with getting an output. And this is how it's set up is, you can build it with your last year's numbers, so you've got your grounding, move it into this year, and what does it mean for our changes? So big changes from this farm from last year to this on those settings, but we know that this can be this can move quite considerably. Every line's a winner, or every line needs to be a winner. In other words, we've got to critically look at every part of our costs. And see what we can do to improve how we spend our dollar and our return, because ultimately that all flows through into you know, where we can improve that bottom line if our settings move and change, which we know that they will. People are asking this question a fair bit, especially where water is at the moment. So, what do we think about that in terms of how much can I pay for water? What do I need to consider? So, can I make that? How much am I going to get from it?
I
else do I have to consider?
What I'm perceiving.
Sorry?
What I'm perceiving in terms of price.
In for the product I get?
Yeah.
So, you know, put it down here. You know, the bottom line. How will that influence that decision? Yep. What else?
Cost of the equipment and feed.
Because water just equals feed, isn't it? What else?
Oops, sorry, I'm pressing that the wrong way. Oh, I'm pressing it.
I know you.
Stop me studying the numbers.
Yeah, I know that. And I don't want the focus on the numbers because as good as it is, that's a fictional farm. It's what's happening on Tomo's farm is the thing that's important, and every one of those lines are going to be different. What? Getting back to the water thing, how much can I pay for the pay for water?
It's a very scary figure
you
work it here.
Sorry, mate?
We've redone that figure and yeah. It doesn't look very good because it shows you how much we can afford to pay as an alternative to what quality we can buy in. And the figure is not... It looks very good for what we can afford to pay for water, but it's not financial.
Well, the other thing you need to consider there is the percentage of your budget you're spending on feed and what impact the higher price of water will have on that. That's the critical factor. When we're talking about alternatives and the cost of water versus the alternative feed, you're talking about that marginal kilo of feed. That's a dangerous conversation to be had here.
Pardon?
That's a dangerous conversation or dangerous thought to be had here based around what I can afford to pay. What I can afford to pay for a marginal kilo of feed is a hell of a lot more than what I can afford to pay for my first kilo. Because I need to keep my feed costs within a certain percentage of my turnover. Yeah. Otherwise my business is in trouble.
So alternatively, in the past we've looked at water as their cheapest food.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you agree, Laurie, but our core cost now, the figure you're about to do, is not very good.
It massively changes those core costs when you start considering water as an alternative to what you can get in.
Absolutely. So we can look at the marginal risk, you know, the extra kilo of buying something relative to something else, which is what some will just do now in a minute. And as you say, that might look really good as in the what we can afford to pay relative to something else. But then we've got to flow it into, you know, our what does that mean for the full picture? Absolutely. And then that helps us inform actually what we do actually end up doing.
You also consider what happens if you don't actually buy, so the impact probably on your business if you don't actually buy.
Yeah, and that's taking it to another level, and it is where we are with where things are sitting, potentially where they could go. Absolutely, we've got to look at that overall impact, and
that's a worst case.
And there was a few things. I don't like going looking back at the drought, but we did learn a few things back then. And one thing we did learn in terms of when all the settings were really dialed the wrong way was that we weren't managing profit; we were managing, you know, a least loss sort of scenario. And for those who wanted to saw a longer-term future in the industry, it was about trying to keep a core together for when things would improve. And we had a bit of a joke there about, you know, and next year looks worse again, but our nature's a bit like that. When it's bad, we think it's going to get worse, and when it's good, we think it's going to get better. But in actual fact, the opposite happens, and we did see things improve. But after that drought picture, what we saw were those, even though it was courageous and it was hard and they might have suffered higher losses for a period by retaining that core herd together, their rebound was so much quicker and made that up so much quicker than those who had the short-term gain of, you know, moving things, cows, etc. Their position of rebound was impaired. But it was hard yakka, there's no doubt about that. Really hard yakka. Not there yet, where we are. And we absolutely have to take in, okay, we can look at the, okay, if I'm looking for feed, purely on that question, what can I afford to pay for water? And then we need to flow that into that the bigger picture. But when we are doing this sum, it's still worthwhile doing the sum and having that understanding. Because if I then say, right, I've done the picture, I'm really looking, I want to get this sort of level of feed, and I'm then now, what is the best way to get that feed? Water is good. If we're putting on good stuff, what will I get? Yeah, we have to take into account our alternatives, but what is a good, well-managed pasture giving my cow? Banana, what is it doing? Sorry? As in the... as a package of feed, how good is it? Yeah, right. But generally speaking, it's a bit of the all-rounder. It's not all equal one. It's quality feed if we're putting it on really good pasture. And the alternative feed to that has got some dollars associated with it. So it's really important when we look at what we actually are putting our water on. And what else is an important consideration about water and whether we should be using it or not?
Are you talking about the intentions around animal health
water? No. I'm not going there.
Efficiencies of putting it on?
The efficiencies, how well you can do it, yep. And that all relates to how much do I get from that megalitre, right? So we're doing all those things we've probably that we did in the past and we will continue to do, you know, good paddocks, good water use efficiency, good setups. There's another thing.
When do I get, you know, consistently, or do I get into the form of maize where I'm not going to get until next March and then...
Yep, so the timing of when you actually get the feed, so that's a factor. I nearly thought you nearly had it where I was wanting to go.
Sorry.
When, as in... So when I use my water, there'll be times of the year when I'm going to get the most possible from it, and other times, you know, I have to think about what response will I get. And just like I said that the spring is so important setting up the season going forward, so it is for how effective we can use the water resources we might have available. If we're going to be using it, you know, we want to really, really maximise this period of time because we're going to get the best growth responses from the meg that we use in this period of time.
A lot of decisions are based on the cash position, too.
The what?
The cash position of their business, whether they can secure the water and the food. The longer they wait, the harder they're probably going to really get it, and the quality will disappear. Those sort of issues.
Yeah.
A well-cashed up fund would be probably securing a good amount of water or feed now.
Yep. And there again, and that's part of the planning, the thinking through, what do I need to do for my business to, and what decisions do I need to make to get to make the most out of what I've got dealt with me? And one of them obviously is to maximise that, and cash flow is an issue around being able to practically implement the decisions you want to make. And so just like with anything, pre-planning, thinking it through and preparing for it and having a talk to Daryl Banker is part of actually being able to implement the decisions we're looking to do. And that's all stems by having a clear picture of what you need to be doing and what you can do, and not spending too much time thinking or wondering about what might happen, because anything could happen I'm thinking about what I can do now, what do I know now, and what can I really be focusing on to get the most out of what I've got now. Though,
you need to look at the real cost of the alternative feed. It's not the price you pay that's delivered on the truck. It's got your labour cost to feed it out, you've got your wastage and so forth. So you've got to compare apples with apples. You've got a forage that's growing, you're watering, the cow's harvested, the other one has a high cost of components and machinery and labour.
Yeah, you're going to factor in all the extras in any decision you need to be making, and they are things that you do absolutely have to consider with working out the comparison between the two. Someone's already talked about this marginal response approach. We can't just always do marginal decisions all the time, because we have to flow that back into what does it mean for the bigger picture, and we've talked a bit about that. But you know, what extra growth will I'm going to get for the extra water I purchase? How does it compare? And if we're thinking about our pasture base, for most farms, there's a fair bit of costs already done. The pasture's there growing. It's now what extra? If we've got it there now, and if we don't put water on it, what's our outcome? What would our outcome be? If we've got our feed base there and we don't put the water in, eh?
Eventually you get rain.
So another thing to take into consideration, we're going to have a dry spring, average spring, wet spring. I don't want to actually hone in on these numbers too much, but basically we have to be responsive to that too. All this is sort of saying is just saying that if we have a dry spring, we don't irrigate, we might get one tonne. If we have a great spring and not require no irrigations, we might get 5 tonnes for no water. I don't quite remember the last time I've had a spring up here that I haven't needed to water. I ignore that one. We could be anywhere around here. And if we apply an irrigation, and we're using it, the first irrigation might be just a little bit hungrier in terms of water use than subsequent ones, and we use a meg in that first, might push that up to 3. We're getting an extra 2 tonnes, and we're getting a 2-tonne response. If we push it out with another irrigation, we might push that out using 1.5 megs and getting 5 tonnes. Extra growth 4 per tonnes per meg, getting about 2.5. And then we can look at our comparisons. But I'd actually prefer to look at more of a realistic number crunch for the value of water in spring. And anyone, we can talk a bit about the assumptions here and how confident we are. But should I buy some water? Well, our sums are basically how much am I looking to buy? How much am I expecting to get? What does that put out in terms of megs, tonnes per megalitre? What's the value of the alternative feed, and taking into account those things you were talking about before, about we've got to consider wastes, etc. And then we can work out, what's the price equivalent or up to what I can do on a megalitre of water. So my number crunch is evolving. I'm going to have 5 irrigations. First one's going to take 1 meg, 4 subsequent ones are going to take 0.5 meg each. I'm going to use about 3 megs. I reckon I'm going to be able to grow that 5 tonnes. So I'm actually getting about 1.6 tonnes for every megalitre of water that I'm using on the farming spring. Does that seem reasonable? A few number crunches. There's a shake of the head there.
Your numbers are completely flawed based on you're not
thinking.
The $300 tonne of boarding feed, is that as it arrives on the back of the truck, is that taking into account any feed out costs, labour, equipment, that sort of thing?
Yeah. So, it is a basic number at this point. And as we progress through, and as we're doing it down on our farm level, we need to work out, work through. But I guess it's some steps. And ultimately, whatever all these numbers are, it's going to be relevant or relative to your own situation. And yes, you then will need to factor in some of those costs that you talked about. We do our price equivalent, $300 a tonne. We're getting 1.6. To be equivalent, nearly $500 a meg. Is that what you mean before about when you do your number, it looks good?
I'm telling you, in this avenue, it may be here, that doesn't look good. Yeah.
And then taking that figure and saying that we can pay $500 a meg and putting it out in the media, where actually that figure will break us, because we know that figure is closer to $100
than
it is $500.
So, an absolutely good, critical point to make. This is just looking at the marginal result.
As a comparison, I understand that.
Yep.
And that's what we've done, that figures at home ourselves.
Yep.
To add that out and not bring it into really with the rest of our business decisions.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's what we have to take into consideration. That flow that through into the full farm business, and what does that look like? Absolutely. But if we're looking, again, at if we're making the call, we need this X amount of feed, water can still be a important consideration. If we have to pay that level for all our feed, it's hard work.
I actually think you might be talking about value there as opposed to cost, because I would suggest that if dairy farmers are to pay that sort of money, and get a return on it, that will never ever happen. $500 a meg. I would be, as a banker, I would be very, very concerned with that number. And I can say that might be the value that a mega water brings in terms of what you can grow in terms of pasture when you're applying those numbers. But that is certainly not what I would say is associated with cost. That's from my point of view.
Yeah. And so, again, it reinforces that what we need to do is, okay, we need to look at the full picture, and the full picture is absolutely critical. To walk out of this room and say we can afford to pay $500 per megalitre of water is absolutely not right. Absolutely not right. We need to flow that into the full business. But if we're looking for, okay, if I'm making this decision, I want extra feed, how does it compare to the alternatives? Then that's a bit of a story we can work through, but we need to flow that through for our full farm and what it fully means for us going forward. And that's where we do all the costs and all the returns and all the factors we factor into when we're looking at our alternative feeds.
The only way that we can pay $300 a tonne for bought in feed, which is something you can throw down a cow straight and will provide a balanced diet, is if you can produce on-farm feeds in the 9 to 13 cents a kilo range. If you're going to say, okay, well, we can increase our on-farm feed cost to $300 a tonne to compete with bought-in feeds, then all of a sudden there's no way you can pay $300 a tonne for bought-in feed, because your budget just does not work.
Yeah. And so what we're trying to just work through here is when we're looking at our farm business, we take the whole picture. And yes, if we can afford to top up our farming feed costs with some bought-in supplements on a low-cost basis to start with, that's how it works. That'd be right?
You will get a low-cost base to start off with.
Yep.
What you're basically putting under attack is the low-cost base, and then saying, oh, we can afford to pay more for the low-cost base based on an alternative, which is around $1 or in. Well, you can't, because the farm will go broke, you will go
ass up bigger than you know.
The other thing that you haven't considered in this is you're saying that's associated with cost, but you haven't related in any way, shape or form what you're actually producing out of that and what you're getting paid for your end product, because that will determine what you can actually afford to pay, not based on the straight out alternative. So there's a big piece of this equation that is missing.
Yeah, and then when we do need to look at our full farm position, How does it all flow through? What does it mean for the business in this line here when we factor in all of the costs that we'll be looking at or needing to think about when we have our potential plan moving forward and cow numbers and milk production and all that sort of thing? What does it really mean here? And whatever that number is, it might be acceptable, I can live with that. I'll go through those decisions to support that. If it's not acceptable, what can I do to try and change it? And sometimes we might be able to move a little bit in some of these things, but what do they do at the end of the day?
At the end of the day, if those figures aren't good already, you're not in this industry.
Yep, that's right. But I guess the point I was going to make is here's where the big numbers are, as they always are, and what can we be doing to try and get the most out of those numbers? If the roll of the dice provides us with a poor spring, milk prices just stay where they are, don't go any south or north, but we have to take advantage of that. And it turns the dial all the long way and we become negative there, then what? Is it time to change the farming system? Don't think so. Do we continue to look at where we can save a dollar? Absolutely. Do we look to reduce cow numbers? Pardon?
That to be done as a short-term fix for the season.
Yep.
Given the way the chopper prices are, but would have to be those kind of decisions would have to be taken in balance with what the young stock you have coming along.
Absolutely. So when we what consideration we have to take into account with the cow number story? Be careful about the short-term gain for long-term pain. But one of the meetings earlier in the week talked about his attitude with his cow numbers was, well, if a cow's not going to be here next year, she may not be here this year. You know, not going too far, but being pretty heavy on that on cows that perhaps aren't quite meeting. Holding their way or paying their way. What about young stock? No weight. They are our foundation and absolutely important to consider that issue when looking at decisions around the young stock.
You could always argue you're across the business that doesn't contain money.
Today it doesn't. Yeah.
It is an uncosty business that potentially costs you money for no return on. So that increase.
For no return on today.
For the rest of the year. Those 2 years for the length of the year, they're a costly business.
Yep. But they are. If you don't have them, what's the issue?
It depends on what price that you can sell them for and the price you can buy them and how milk accounts milk at the current moment.
Yep, you can take those into considerations. Yep. And there's with any decision that we implement and think about, there's risks around it. So if we sell young stock and we want to then rebuy it back later on, will we, can we? Cow health issues, all things like that. We have to factor those things into our decisions. What else could we be thinking about doing, as we plan forward this year?
So if you're going to cull heavier this year, you actually need to make sure that you have got the young stock on that you can replace, all those cow numbers with when things do improve. Because if you haven't, then you're actually putting yourself into probably a worse position. Further down the track.
Yeah.
So you can't take a short-term view of it. That's the first thing. The second thing is that turn around and say, okay, then in terms of sitting down and going through your budget, then absolutely you will go through it and say, these are the things that I can do, these are the things that I won't do. And you know, one of the first things, whenever we have a reduction in price, one of the first things that we should always look at is how do we, you know, like maintain or improve production to you know, minimise the effect of a lower price and assessing costs associated with doing that. So, you know, like one of the things that should be, you know, looked at is, okay, cost of feed, certainly, but also if you bring on more cows, you're lowering your actual fixed costs on a per cow basis overall. And you could actually be improving your production levels. Because if you are in a situation where a megalitre of water is going to cost a fair whack of dough versus buying an alternative feed, you know, it might be a year when you say, rightio, I am going to be better off by buying in more feed and I wouldn't say donor to it, you know, but having more cows as a that are fed on a standoff basis.
Yeah,
actually,
you're
right.
When
you add more cows to it, always be better.
Pardon,
mate? What the price?
Yeah.
You can work that in the drought.
That's right.
What's that?
Any spreadsheet you run and you add more cows to it, always looks better, no matter what the price is.
Yep.
But I always send it back to, if you had 10 bricks and I'll give you an extra brick, you just those 10 bricks in your life.
That's right.
Whatever it is.
Yeah, and that's it's a point about spreadsheets and stuff that we do also have to be really conscious of. And we can make them come up with whatever number we want, because you can just go click, and that brick is not very heavy when you do that. But when we factor that in to and apply the risk associated with it, the fact that we know that things can change and what we assume might happen may not necessarily happen. That's where the complexity of farm decision making comes into play. Because it's not 1 + 1 = 2, because that's what the maths say will happen. 1 + 1 can give us a different answer because of all these things that happen, which makes farm decision making complex, and which makes farmers who have to constantly make those decisions a skill that it's hard yakka, and anyone who says that you know, farming's easy has got no idea. Just back a step, and that's been really solid conversation, and it's good. But getting back to my spring story, and you know, making every post a winner is, if we do then make the decision that we're going to do the water, then we need to make sure that we get absolutely the most possible out of that resource. As we should always do, but it just really, that extra importance to do that is now, you know, with where the settings are. So, putting on, you know, the basics, isn't it, Durham? Putting on stuff that we know is going to get a response, so good quality feed. We assess our paddocks, as we always should do, you know, whether we think we're going to get the response. And then, you know, we apply all our solid management practices to ensure that we, you know, we get the best most possible out of that meg. And we might turn the dial a bit more on some of our other inputs on our pasture base to get more out of it. So things like nitrogen, worth doing? Yeah.
Excellent.
So, you know, getting the additional, we've already got all these costs there. Let's try and push that as far as we possibly can in a cost-effective manner. And the business tool that we've got, that people can actually do some playing around, you know, the marginal responses, the little partial budgets to work out, you know, am I, you know, should I consider that this is an option, is there, and people can play around with their heart's content about it. Oops. But just to give a bit of outline, I don't want that one. So this is about, you know, the nitrogen story. So, you know, we factor in what extra we're going to get and what do we expect to get back from that. And yes, it's all against an alternative feed, but if we're thinking about we want to find some feed and what's the cheapest relative feed that we can get, well, less expensive, but cheapest is probably not the right word. You know, what sort of response are we going to get out of our kilogram of feed and what of nitrogen and what is the cost of our alternative? And we can put all whatever number we feel comfortable with in what we can get. We might be applying 20 tonnes of urea. We factor in how much N is that going to give us, the cost of that. You know, it just basically goes through what are the extra costs relative to and then valuing that fee on our alternatives. And for this example, using the 20 tonnes we're coming out with to get the equivalent amount of feed through the nitrogen versus buying that equivalent of feed, we're getting a significant benefit in doing so if we're chasing that feed. It's just number crunching, but what we need to do to work through trying to get the most out of the current bundle of resources we have available when we know that all the settings here will make things tight going forward.
In that, just to hold you up there for a minute, Daryl,
yeah.
In those numbers, have you allowed for the conservation of that extra food? Have you allowed for the contractor, et cetera, to put it away? Because you would have to assume you've already got enough to feed your cows when you're throwing the nitrogen around the screen.
Yeah.
And that what you're generating is actually a true surplus.
Yeah.
Or a surplus. So then it has to be conserved. So that figure there that gave us a $20 surplus or something like that.
Yeah.
Did that factor in the harvest cost of that additional food?
So?
Any loss associated with
it? Yeah. So if that's another cost that's going to incur when you're going through that decision, you can put it in the numbers, right? And this example, well, this number includes 50% of the feed being conserved. So there is actually a cost for that. And you do what? Whoops. Again, so. You put in it's 100% of it to be, you know, extra cost of conserving. You put that in your number and do your calculation. So it's got a bit of that in this example. And I just want to re-emphasize, not to get too hung up in the numbers, what we're talking about here, it's the process, but fundamentally underneath, you know, nitrogen still will hold an opportunity for us to get more out of what we've got available to us and a tool to use. And for every extra kilo of feed that we can get growing and at its most cost-less position, the better off we'll be.
So this comes back to pretty much saying, okay, you don't buy a meter of water, you don't grow this much feed. If you use nitrogen, you grow that much, you know, that much more.
Yep.
Which ultimately means that the efficiency of your water is enhanced. And
yep.
That's really the story here.
Absolutely. Yeah. And during the next period of time, next 10 weeks, 12 weeks, is where we're probably going to get our best responses. And there's a couple other things there that the tool goes through, but again, it's working through, you know, every situation as each unique situation. So winding up, it's not about don't panic, but plan. We are collectively nervous about where things are situated, and rightly so, but we absolutely need to know where we sit right now, and working through our whole farm budget, not just looking at the break-even point of all the cost comparativeness of the water buy. Look at it in the full farm context. Every farm's different. Developing a plan will mean developing and reviewing it all the time, keeping abreast of what's happening, keeping abreast with your milk companies about what's going on in that milk price scene, all will have to be known, and then look at what that might mean when we get more information, more certainty in information. You know, doing our feed and water and financial budgets, always important, more so now. There's people out there who can help people in terms of, people will use their advisors and their all their advisors collectively. There's a few different resources available. One thing we actually haven't talked a bit, unless I missed what you might have said, Neil, but Dairy Australia do have a hay and grain report that's updated, I think it's updated weekly, isn't it?
It's about 44 issues a year.
nearly weekly. And that's done with some industry people who are basically, really got the finger on the pulse. So that's just a quick grab, and you can look at where things are sitting there. There's the tools like the Murray Dairy Business Tool. Murray Dairy is going to be doing some further updates, and obviously your stuff that you write there in terms of what will be useful going forward is valuable for Murray Dairy to help set the direction. And for those, some people may have heard about Dairy Base. Dairy Base is a new program or tool that DA have put a lot of resource into. It's a taking stock, but enhanced, and just allows people to actually start working out where they're at, and quite a useful tool to do that. And then knowing where you're starting from certainly helps you know to where you're going to get to, and can't reiterate the importance of doing that, and doing that on a regular basis. You know, there is no rose-coloured glasses here. What we've got in front of us is a challenge, but as always, and as we have experienced in the past, it's working through, thinking through the decisions, and getting plans on paper is useful. Sometimes the numbers mightn't be what we want to see at the end of the day, but not knowing them is worse. And then factoring in decisions to try and get the most out of what we've got in front of us is how we need to operate going forward.